When you hear the word Canada, what are the different words that come into your head?
Snow.
Canada français.
Healthcare.
Maple syrup.
Mooses.
Hockey.
peacekeepers.
Not the United States.
I'm the Canadian, very good. The best.
Tales of Canada as a peacekeeping, freedom-defending, and ultimately compassionate country are written deeply into the Canadian identity. The Canadian government has used these myths to convince the nation that increased military spending and ongoing participation in global conflicts are justified. At the same time, the government then takes an active role in reconstruction and redevelopment of devastated regions. This is treated by the Canadian public as a moral duty without other interests at play. The history of Canada will not be remembered by these comforting myths, but rather by the reality of its actions. This documentary explores how the Canadian government, its allies, and its industries have crafted and exploited these myths for their own profit, and how Canadian public is left to reconcile how it has been convinced to pay for industries of war it truly believed were industries of peace.
The Cold War was based on a premise, and the premise was that you had two conflicting ideologies, some kind of Soviet totalitarianism and American liberty and freedom. And what Canada was doing during the Cold War was principally this peacekeeping.
Your Majesty knows, and the world knows, that Canada as a peacekeeper has always been there.
For 40 years following the first UN effort, Canada participated in every UN-led peacekeeping operation. We were in Africa, in the Middle East, on the border between India and Pakistan, in Cyprus, in the Balkans. More than 125,000 Canadian soldiers have served in traditional peacekeeping. More than 125 have been killed while on UN-mandated duty.
I mean, traditional peacekeeping, you're invited in to monitor a ceasefire. But by doing that, they kept it front and center, they kept on perpetuating the myth. They even had pictures of a guy carrying a child with a teddy bear. This is what we do. People loved it, right? So that's now, you know, that is imprinted upon our brains.
I think the peacekeeping mythology lies at the heart of Canadian mythologies, and
It does so for the very specific reason that it is perfect for a middle power nation. If you want to dress yourself up as a particular kind of civilized nation, you can't do that generically. And so the way to do that has to be to secure for yourself a very specific role. And that role has been the role of, as Robertson Davies put it so long ago, the hero's friend. So we're okay. We don't want to be the hero. We're just the hero's friend. And Canadians, I think, have deeply internalized this. And it's not surprising that they have, since we are actually taught it in every way, at school, through CBC, regular documentaries, this kind of thing. We are taught this.
Get down! All of you! You cockroach!
Drop your weapon. Your men are disarmed and the place is surrounded. You will drop your weapon.
It was Canada that proposed the United Nations Peacekeeping Force in 1956. General Jacques Dextraz of the Royal Fusiliers of Montreal would later become head of our armed forces.
Who are you? Dextraz, United Nations Peacekeeping Force.
It's a very attractive position to be in because it enables us to deny our own internal colonialism. So you'll get prominent figures. I'll always remember Ed Broadbent saying, of the NDP, actually saying, we are not a colonial nation. We have never colonized anyone. Well, what do you call First Nations here if not colonized? I think it offers Canadians this wonderful place of innocence. It's very seductive. We all fall for it every time. It's such a relief not to be a big bad American. And this is what's attractive about the mythology, and it's deeply, deeply internalized.
Canada takes understandable pride in the fact that our Minister of Foreign Affairs and future Prime Minister Lester Pearson was the originator of the idea of a United Nations peacekeeping force back in 1956. Pearson's work gave birth to the United Nations Emergency Force, and he received the Nobel Peace Prize in 1957 for his efforts.
I share this honor with many friends and colleagues who have worked with me for the promotion of peace and good understanding between people.
For some reason, Canadians always want to hear that as long as it's got the UN blessing, that somehow that makes it okay. And I think we've, you know, and we sort of bathe ourselves in that thing that we're an international peacekeeper and it's all for the international good, and if 192 countries accept it, then it must be okay. But we never look at the fine print as what it is we're doing.
Peacekeeping has always disappeared into national memory as something heroic. It's never, ever revealed as something that is connected to political gain, economic gain. And yet, from its very beginnings, it was always that. Even the very earliest peacekeeping missions were entirely connected to Canada sort of making a claim, either an economic one or a political one.
Canada's economic and political claims over the last 60 years can best be put into context through an understanding of the Cold War. Conventional history describes the Cold War as a conflict between good, freedom-loving democracies and bad, freedom-denying communism. In this story, Canada and its NATO allies were the good guys. Rather than a tension between two great rivals, it would be more accurate to describe the Cold War as a global conflict led by the superpowers to maintain and expand control over territories and markets. Over this same period, attempts by colonized and exploited countries to achieve sovereignty were concealed and oppressed. This persistent state of global war allowed and empowered both democratic and communist states to expand on foreign soil.
During the Suez Crisis, which had Israel, France, and the United Kingdom invading Egyptian territory following President Nasser's nationalization of the Suez Canal, Minister Pearson suggested that, quote, the United Nations send an international force to the area, position itself between the warring parties, and bring an end to the hostilities.
With the arrival of Canadian General E.L.M. Burns, who will command the UN force of 6,000, preparations for keeping the peace swing into high gear.
Any Arab who takes the, who has the opportunity or takes the trouble to read the Canadian press and the Canadian, watch the Canadian media generally, will see that nearly everything that is put forward there is leaning towards the Israeli side of things. Now that is one of the main reasons why it seems to me the Arabs don't look on us as impartial.
In Egypt, the Canadian peacekeepers and the peacekeepers in general were eventually kicked out by the Egyptian government, which was a part of the non-aligned movement and part of the Third World. And they said, you're actually working on behalf of the West. So this was something that was quickly understood in the Third World, that peacekeepers were not the neutral heroes, but were actually part of a Western alliance to do Western countries' policy agendas. And Canada was not really hiding this for a lot of its history.
The raison d'etre for Canada's intervention in that instance was not the regional one, but the direct impact on Canadian public opinion.
Most people remember Canada's military and diplomatic interventions over the last 60 years as peacekeeping missions. But in fact, many of these efforts concealed Canada's role in the growth of Western dominance around the globe, sometimes through the United Nations and often through NATO.
NATO, a strong today for a safe tomorrow. Hello there, children. I'm here today to talk to you about something called NATO. Do you know what NATO is? I didn't think so. Think of NATO as a boat sailing the Atlantic Ocean. Now everyone on this boat are great friends, much like you and your schoolyard chums. Just like your pals on the schoolyard, NATO member countries look out for each other. Indeed, the world can be a dangerous place, but by working together, the NATO boat stays afloat. But how did all these NATO countries come to be such good friends? Well, the early 20th century was a time when important men with big ideas tried things out to see what worked. Needless to say, everyone didn't always get along, and the resulting misunderstanding came to be known as World War II. With the end of the war, and so many troublemakers out of the way, it became clear to many of the world's straight-shooting countries that they'd better not get caught by surprise again. With the growing robustness of the Soviet Union and its different way of doing things, some countries grew concerned that the Soviets might turn out to be even bigger troublemakers than Hitler and his friends had been. In any case, a few ramshackle nations banded together to form the well-meaning but hideously inadequate Western European Union. It was obvious to all that these limp-wristed Europeans couldn't hold out for long against the impending menace and poisonous ideas of the Soviet Union. They needed help. In fact, what they needed was the United States of America. As, by this time, with the help of the atom bomb, the USA had proved itself to be the greatest country in the world. The hop-to-it, go-getter attitude of the United States, other countries were quick to follow their lead in building a safer world. These countries were Canada, Denmark, Iceland, Italy, Norway, and for what it was worth, Portugal. So, in 1949, all these countries signed the North Atlantic Treaty, forming the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, or NATO. This treaty helped to ensure a new era of peace, happiness, and prosperity that came to be known as the Cold War. This was a fine time for Western civilization, as NATO was more than simply a military alliance. It was in fact a banding together of right-minded countries who had realized that they all shared common values, democracy, freedom, and free market capitalism. And they were making new friends all the time. Now, with the remilitarization of West Germany, the Soviets and their friends had made their own agreement, albeit a less wholesome one. The Warsaw Pact, signed in 1955 by Albania, Bulgaria, Czechoslovakia, East Germany, Hungary, Poland, Romania, and of course the Soviet Union, was much like a pact that one might sign with the devil. The communists' decision to isolate themselves from the civilized world was cemented in their building of the Berlin Wall, which separated the German city of Berlin into the communist East and the free and breezy West. Indeed, tensions remained high throughout the Cold War as Western democratic powers kept a close watch on the Soviet Union. Unfortunately, the NATO treaty at this time didn't call for action unless a NATO country was directly threatened. So, most often, they supported their friends with funding and equipment. Overall, however, the NATO alliance was successful, as peace was maintained and the feared nuclear exchange between East and West never took place. By 1989, the weight of the great Soviet bear finally took its toll on the evil empire, and the Berlin Wall came down, reuniting the Germanies and prompting the collapse of the Soviet Union. NATO was finally victorious, and by 1991, the USSR was officially dismantled. As a result of the Cold War, numerous bases around the world were now home to NATO troops. And every year, NATO member countries had taken to investing important amounts of money into ensuring world safety. During the 10 years following the collapse of the Soviet Union, NATO had a bit of an identity crisis. They didn't know if they were coming or going. But when ethnic violence broke out and shattered the former Yugoslavia, NATO stepped forward to the rescue with the humanitarian bombings that still define NATO today as peacekeepers of the world. Indeed, this incident proved beyond a doubt that NATO still has a purpose in the world today. To keep the world safe for you and me, and to punish our enemies. Yes, without NATO, life in the West would be as brutish and short as it is in the East. And that alone is reason enough for NATO to stick around for a long, long time. That's right, NATO is there, ensuring all of us a strong today for a safe tomorrow. After all, history won't dictate itself, you know.
After the Cold War, there was no real purpose. I mean, for the military, for them to justify their budget, they were like, well, how do we continue to exist? So, of course, they polled like crazy. And Canadians loved peacekeeping, as long as we were peacekeeping. When we deployed into the Balkans, and it was very easy for us to do that because we had the brigade based in Germany, so we could have a disproportionately large presence in the Balkans, but it was because we could have either paid to ship the stuff home or we could have shipped it in and put this face on it, which Canadians enjoyed, right? They kept it sanitized, what the guys were actually seeing and doing. I mean, the whole horror of the Balkans was pretty much played down. Guys that were getting killed, getting wounded, because that wasn't what people wanted to see. That was gonna upset them a little bit if our guys are engaging in combat under blue helmets.
The whole Charter of the United Nations was against that idea that, you know, military force should only be used in the collective interest, unless it's you're under attack and it's in self-defense. Americans hated that idea. They hated having to make deals in the UN. They lost control of the UN after decolonization in the 1960s, where they suddenly were a minority in the Security Council, a minority in the General Assembly. So they want to break out of the UN.
Well, I think Canadians want to believe that we're doing this of our own free will. and that, or that it's part of an obligation, as part of an alliance. And for NATO, I mean, us having served as NATO soldiers during the Cold War, where we believed a clear purpose, right? It was a defensive alliance, to suddenly be going on the offensive.
We had this independence movement in Kosovo, which is natural. It was a large ethnic majority of Muslim Kosovar Albanians. But the Americans, instead of sort of treating it as a very sensitive thing that had to be worked out among the parties, the Americans encouraged the Kosovo Liberation Army. They said, well, you know, we're on your side. Provoke a crisis and we'll come in and solve it militarily. And they did create a crisis. And they looked for various atrocities, which committed horrible, horrible things that happened, usually provoked, according to UN documents, provoked by the Kosovo Liberation Army. And then the Serbs overreact, and civilians get killed. And this was a setup. It was a complete setup to justify this war. And NATO had its own reasons, a million reasons. One is it wanted to test its weaponry. Most importantly, I think it was a war against the UN. I think they wanted a humanitarian crisis so they could justify a unilateral intervention, which a lot of scholars had been arguing for. Nobody had accepted it. The World Court had rejected it, but the Americans were pushing this idea. So they didn't need the UN to make war. They could make it unilaterally.
Even Canadians, we want to believe that we're not warlike. But whenever the war drums beat, surprisingly, I mean, Canadians did get pumped up on the bombing campaign in 99. And then, of course, there was like this huge national pride that we were involved in the very first air raids, and our, we showed them kind of thing, right? We started dropping bombs.
20,000 bombs were dropped during the 78-day of bombing of Serbia. 10% of all these combat missions and bombing was done by Canadian aircrafts.
In terms of Canada's direct contribution to the war against Yugoslavia, there are a number of different ways, probably at least a dozen major ways that Canada contributed. One of the ways, an important way, was through diplomacy, diplomatic endorsement, support, promotion, public relations for the war.
NATO is fighting for the cause of humanity. NATO cannot fail. NATO will not fail.
Lloyd Oxworthy was, together with Tony Blair, Prime Minister of Great Britain, the one who promoted humanitarian intervention, humanitarian bombing.
Because the more pressure that can be applied, the better the likelihood of having a diplomatic solution.
NATO itself broke its own charter because NATO was a defensive organization. It was formed to defend countries, members of NATO, not to wage an aggressive war as it did in 1999.
Well, in 99, I mean, NATO basically ignored the UN. They went around it, and they were using for the justification the fact that the UN had basically failed to make peace in the Balkans up until the Dayton Accord, and then NATO had to come in and enforce it. So then they took it to the next level and said, no, we're not going to wait for that. Now we're going to jump in and do it ourselves.
The relationship is the legitimation of war, aggressive war, outside of the United Nations framework.
The irony of all of this is that Canada was the most bellicose country of all NATO countries. They were so pro-war that Art Eggleton even wanted ground troops to be sent immediately to Serbia.
The proof really comes at a time when Canada is asked to provide its troops, such as we have in Kosovo. And we have been able to deliver when we have been asked.
This guise of peacekeeping, this guise of humanitarian intervention, humanitarian war, and democracy. This is not democracy, this is war. Depleted uranium bombs were dropped, cluster bombs were dropped, all prohibited by law. Bridges were bombed. refugee camps were bombed. All major cities in Serbia were bombed. All refineries were bombed. Everything was just devastating.
There is a pattern in relation to Western states' involvement in the collapse of former Yugoslavia. There was war. A lot of them imposed sanctions. Then there was also bombing. There was occupation, some form of new colonialization. And in the end, the same powers and the companies from the same countries came back with assistance, assisting development. They were the ones offering loans, and the destroyed countries had no other alternative but accepting financial packages from foreign countries. Companies from those same foreign countries were the ones who won the bids for privatizing big companies, and it's clear that they privatized those businesses in the way that it suited them, and not that it suited national interests or people's interests.
Good evening. It's been an historic day for NATO. For the first time ever, the world's most powerful military alliance is on a mission outside of Europe. It's taken over command of an international peacekeeping force in Afghanistan, and Canada is playing a major part.
The Canadian people and government understand the importance of our evolving engagement in Afghanistan as part of the international partnership to rebuild the country.
In Afghanistan, for us as Canadians, we always tell ourselves, well, it's under a UN resolution. And that's what the government tells us. It's a UN resolution, NATO command and control. So, I mean, we're there as part of these bigger organizations. Well, that wasn't how it went down. Americans ignored the UN, went in on Operation Enduring Freedom, invaded Afghanistan. Then, in the anarchy that existed afterwards, I mean, the fact that there was this vacuum, they went to the UN and said, well, can we get a resolution to provide a security force to build a stable country? And they said, of course. So that was when that UN resolution came into play, and that was for a security force, which of course ended up being the ISAF, International Security Assistance Force, which we became a part of. And again, it's, you know, we've got the force there now, and it's become a perpetual war.
We are in the middle of a major conflict, therefore, what we are doing in Afghanistan is not peacekeeping.
The recent wars in Afghanistan and Iraq were done against United Nations authority, without United Nations authority. They're aggressive wars. The Afghanistan war was an aggressive war, and the Iraq war was an aggressive war. These are major international conflicts. You see hundreds of thousands of people dead. These were wars that were justified originally on the Kosovo precedent.
Canadians just sort of unwittingly, merrily go along with what the United States wanted, and we get drawn into this stuff.
What the United States needed was a series of allies to give it a bilateral sense, to give it a sense that the entire world was supporting this war on Afghanistan and this invasion of Afghanistan, and that's what Canada provided.
And so we could end up defending pipeline corridors through Afghanistan, because you know where the route goes? I couldn't believe it. When we actually looked at the maps where the route goes, it starts in Turkmenistan, goes right through Herat province, right down the highway, through Kandahar, and right into Pakistan, through the heart of the where, and if you overlay it with where all the Canadian soldiers have been killed, it's right along the same path, because it's a main highway corridor where all the fighting happens there, and where the pipeline would go. The Americans are doing the same old game. It's all about energy politics. It's a great game of the great energy game. Kretchian has spent a lot of time in Turkmenistan, I gotta say, since he left office. He's now a lobbyist for some energy companies and goes to Turkmenistan regularly.
Ask questions about how we're implicated in people's lives. What are we getting out of Afghanistan? Do we have a stake in those pipelines? You know, we're not able to work out Rwanda. Where were we in Rwanda? Stephen Lewis and other people are quite happy to show the Belgians had a lot to gain, but they don't mention what we might have to gain.
When it is politically and economically profitable, wealthy countries and their military alliances will often occupy a region under the guise of humanitarian intervention. If wars, famines, or genocides are occurring in a region that is not economically or politically useful, interventions rarely occur. There are numerous examples of this phenomena, including Rwanda, Gaza, Sudan, and East Timor. It is clear that military intervention is not about humanitarianism, but rather about strategic gain. Canada's military forces are justified by calls to defense and the protection of global security. The myth of Canada as a global good guy plays on the heartstrings of Canadians and serves to silence questions and critiques. All the while, this myth hides the interests of the dominant economic players and their agendas.
On September 11th, after the World Trade Center collapsed, the border was closed for 3 days. This sent a panic through Bay Street in Canada. The border's closed. All of the gains that we had made in NAFTA, they would say, risk being unraveled because of this new security measures that are going to be put into the United States. We've got to counter this. And the theory was that we had to convince the Americans to not put all their security measurements at the border, at the 49th parallel. No. Put it around North America. And we'll be inside. We'll put Canada inside the fortress. That way we can preserve the market integration that we want, that we worked so hard for. This is how they would argue it. Well, to do that, they would have to absolutely trust Canada that Canada's security measures were identical to the United States. Otherwise, they wouldn't trust us and they would start building up on the border again. So that's where the connection with the defense guys come in. This alliance evolves between the defense lobby and the corporate lobby.
Once again, we expect to turn to industry as an essential partner. Investments in defense are investments in our future. These investments are dependent on the defense industry.
Most Canadians probably have no idea that this country has so many corporations that are producing military equipment. Canada is producing a lot of component parts. We don't make very many complete weapon systems, but we make a lot of high-tech electronic component parts that go into weapon systems. We export them, so then these components, these electronics, get assembled into complete weapon systems in the United States or in other countries, and basically they're used in whatever wars those countries want to use them in. We have to realize that the Canadian government subsidizes the war industries. The government gives hundreds of millions of dollars over the years to a company, and then the company rewards the political party that's in power. And it also hedges its bets by also funding the political party which doesn't happen to be in power. It adds up to about $4 billion over the past, over about 20, 25 years. That's a lot of money to be just handing out. You know, when people think about welfare bums, they have to consider corporate welfare bums. Handing out billions and billions of dollars to highly profitable industries, and that's what it amounts to. And that's done through Industry Canada. Many Canadians don't realize is that through the Canada Pension Plan, we're forced to invest our retirement savings in military industries. The Canada Pension Plan Investment Board invests in tobacco and in huge mining companies. And in some research that I did back in 2003, I found that about $2.5 billion worth of Canada Pension Plan money was being invested in military industries. So Canadians are being forced to invest their pension money in all of these war industries.
And Paul Martin made some mistakes. And on the defense file, you know, I would say he made some big ones. One of his first, in late 2004, was to appoint controversial Rick Hillier as the Chief of Defense Staff. And he was a huge author of what we're experiencing now. He wanted to transform the Canadian military in many ways. Skillful operators could rewrite the rules of Canada's military relationship with the media and the government, as Hillier did, dramatically expanding the General's power and influence in Ottawa. Hillier did a lot more. I mean, he won a massive increase in military spending for new weapons and new recruits, and we're spending all this money on the war, all this money on armaments. They're signing up all these contracts. We're not going to be able to get out of them. It's going to tie the hands of the government for a generation.
The term defense is really a euphemism that the corporations and the government like to use. To create an impression in the public mind of what these industries are. I prefer to call them war industries, but to call them defense industries, or you hear about defense budgets and defense ministers and departments of defense, and what are they really defending?
The Conservatives put forward a 20-year projection called the Canada First Defense Strategy. First, they made this big announcement and released no paper on it. And the reporter said, "What are you guys doing?" It was this big military fanfare thing in a big hangar in Halifax where they did it. Then finally on Friday night, on the last day of the session, before the summer holidays, up on the D&D website comes this plan, the Canada First Defense Plan. And in it was a laundry list of all the different equipment they wanted to buy. And the overall sum was $490 billion over 20 years, almost a half trillion dollars. It includes that budget of about $19 billion per year, plus an annual percentage increase for 20 years. So it's cumulative over that time, $490 billion.
When we asked for details about the government's defense spending plan, we were told the Prime Minister's speech was all the detail that Canadians needed. Worse, this plan started at $30 billion, went to $50 billion, then to $96 billion, and is now nearing half a trillion dollars. Mr. Speaker, even Dr. Evil would be impressed with that.
Thank you.
Canada's stated military purpose is providing defense and security. Canada's military actions, however, often protect the prosperity and profits of Canadian industry, who benefit substantially from political and economic devastation. States are economically stimulated by militarization, and therefore continue to participate in global conflicts. This economic dependence means that the privileged lifestyles of most North Americans fundamentally rests on industries of war. The story of Canada helping people who are suffering around the world is one Canadians take particular pride in. This myth allows the showcasing of altruistic behavior and reinforces the unquestioned role and legitimacy of Canadian aid spending. Canadian tax-funded programs and projects appear as though they are meant to provide help and development abroad. Yet these programs often conceal policies and objectives that ensure a majority of aid money will return as profit to Canada.
Ladies and gentlemen, first I want to thank the organizing committee for giving me the opportunity to come here and talk to you, give you a brief overview of the CEDA Industrial Cooperation Program, CEDA Inc., known in Canada. The main goal of that program is to promote economic and social development by encouraging Canadian firms in investment and in participating also in major infrastructure projects. We want to strengthen entrepreneurship and public services in developing and in transition countries. We want to help the Canadian private sector to get involved in international venture, commercial ventures.
The intent is to find those things and identify where Canada can bring expertise, where Canada can be value added.
So what we do is that we invite Canadian consultants, experts, to share their experience, the Canadian experience, with our partners in Serbia.
There's the fact that lots of aid is spent on technical assistance, which is consultancy, research and training, widely regarded to be not as effective as it should be. The problem is that it's the donors, it's the people giving the money who are deciding what that money gets spent on. And so inevitably, some of that money gets captured by special interest groups, gets pushed towards particular preferences of the donor country. So one good example is the tying of aid to goods and services from the donor country. So essentially it's a subsidy for donor industries rather than an attempt to help the poor. When I talk about aid in this context, I'm talking about the aid that governments give. So that is ultimately raised through taxes. So the Canadian government gives just a little over $1 billion every year in international aid. You know, there's 1 billion people in the world living on less than $1 a day. There's 800 million people going hungry every day. And yet the Canadian government is effectively reducing the value of the money it's giving to the poor countries by insisting on spending it on Canadian goods and services. And it's not trivial. So, as I said, the IMF expects that tying aid increases costs by 25%. So you could get 25% for every dollar the Canadian government is spending in poor countries. It could get an extra 25 cents if it untied its aid. And that would make an enormous difference.
Canada is a member of many multilateral agencies and regional banks that use the jargon of wanting to help people and develop nations. These agencies and banks, in fact, have a long track record of funding projects that have devastating social and environmental impacts.
If people want to understand the way a foreign aid project comes into being, it generally happens this way. You have the big institutions like the World Bank, huge, huge financial institutions that are financed by all of us, taxpayers from the rich countries. They come up with a plan, a big master plan, and they say this country, in order to have electricity, must build the following dams. So then what happens is once the big master plan is designed, then a lot of the other aid institutions and the export credit institutions come along and they say, let's get our money in there, public funds always, in order to finance our companies from our country to actually build these projects. And so it ends up being a big construction project. This is what aid agencies, in essence, are doing.
The bank was created in 1990 after the fall of the Berlin Wall. It was an idea that was developed by the Europeans, and they got the interest of Canadians, Australians, Japanese, a few others, what I think is a great idea, how to help those countries rebuild their economies, move from having been planned economies to market economies, go through a process of transition. And the other goal was to support the movement towards democracy in those countries.
What is reconstruction really about? Reconstruction is really about the same kinds of things that these other forms of intervention are, whether they're diplomatic or economic or military. They're about trying to restructure a society in the interests of the country that's doing the reconstruction.
As a Canadian, as a representative of the Canadian government, I sit on the board of the EBRD, and so I can influence all of the decisions that are made, because all of the investment projects are brought to the attention of the board of directors for our approval. Canada has an agency of the government that helps fund export. We work closely with them as well.
Export to Home of Canada was established right after Second World War, and the purpose of this institution is to support and develop Canadian exports.
Canadian aid and trade is primarily designed to finance Canadian corporations. And they do that. Our aid institutions and our export credit institution, which is called EDC, Export Development Canada, does that by subsidizing projects in third world countries. So they are typically hydro dams, mining operations, and things like that.
Our role is not only supporting direct exports, but we believe that Canadian direct investment is very important for the economy of Canada, and also to strengthen the Canadian companies.
The problem with these projects is that they generally don't make economic sense. They are not subject to any kind of market discipline, and the additional problem is that they're generally not subject to public oversight either.
There have been a number of projects that have been supported over the years that have had problematic results or impacts that have generated significant environmental or social impacts. One example is the Omai mine, which is infamous because an environmental disaster took place at that mine in Guyana, and a large number of indigenous people were adversely affected.
не може да се вярва. Един привечер така, настъмняване, са влезнали от коли така, нали, без наше знание, са сондирали и на третата сонда я удариха точно на дамара, на тая вода, на този извор. И сега водата отиде някъде, разпиля се, не може да я събираме. Сега хората са без вода. Покарваме им вода от сената махала.
Precious metals clearly stated that they want to use the cyanide in both projects, and of course this raises very serious concerns about the health and environmental risks.
I think the sad reality is that foreign aid and export credit, in fact, promotes conflict in other countries. If you look at the Three Gorges Dam, for example, which has the Canadian flag draped all over it, we financed the feasibility study. We were the first country, the first government to jump in and say, we will finance this dam. We'll finance Canadian exporters to help build this dam. Then a number of other countries jumped in as well with their export credit. Well, that project is causing extraordinary harm. Throughout the river valley, there are now massive landslides. There are over 1 million people who have been resettled. Most of them are still destitute, leading to citizen uprisings in the area, leading to really a devastation of the communities that once lived along this river valley.
Canada, their own Standing Committee on Foreign Affairs and International Trade, admitted that Canada does not yet have any laws that ensure that Canadian mining companies, or Canadian companies at all, operating abroad respect human rights or the rights of Indigenous people and labor rights.
If people are wondering why developing countries enter into these agreements, part of it is that their governments are not actually representing the desires of their people. Whenever there is a degree of democratic choice, people in those countries do reject these policies, and they do reject these deals.
Ми од Попинци миналата година си бехме направиле лагер горе на местността Петелово и протестирахме 36 дни, защото не искаме да се тровим с тия цениди. И затова решихме да си запазим селото и всички околни села.
There are lots of pieces of the puzzle in which we are heavily implicated that we have to think about. And so if we are confining ourselves to this heroic story of helping them out of their chaos, then I think we're on the wrong path.
While there are many stories that are commonly understood as truth, other facts are sorely neglected or denied. The idea that Canada is a peacekeeping nation, that our defense priorities are to provide security, and that our aid and development policies are used for humanitarian purposes, must be investigated and challenged. While Canadians take in these stories, big business is left quietly to operate and take in incredible profit. Canada's contribution to history will not be marked by comforting myths, but by the reality of its actions.
If the Canadian state and Canadian corporations are participating in denying other peoples their sovereignty, then that's something that makes us all less free. It's not to our credit as Canadians, and it's something that we have to change.
One thing people can do, one thing Canadians should do is certainly educate themselves more about what their government is doing. People have to look for alternative sources of information. They shouldn't rely on corporate media for their information about wars that are being led for corporate purposes.
I think that, you know, if we started to say, no, we've got to change, just like we've got to change our relationship with the environment, we have to change our relationship with the third world. We have to stop exploiting. We have to stop oppressing. We have to stop putting them under our boots, supporting oppressive regimes because they serve our interests, like in Saudi Arabia and Egypt. And I think that would be good for us. It would be good for the world. I think it's possible.
There ain't no nations, no nations today. Cha-ching when they sell your freedoms and your rights away. They be getting rich, stuffing dollars in their mouth. They be getting rich when they exploit the global south. There ain't no China, nigga. There ain't no USA. There ain't no borders either. You gotta pay to play. Come to Canada, that shit will cost $1 million. Or lend 800,000, the beast will reinvest. Meanwhile, you stressing, trying to pass the test. White people hating on you, they think you taking over. But you say F you was evicted by their soldiers. That's why you come around, that's why you touch down. But you don't get 6 points, you gotta pay to play. There ain't no nations, no nations today. Cha-ching when they sell your freedoms and your rights away. They be getting rich, stuffing dollars in their mouth. Baby, they be getting rich when they exploit the global south. The south is coming up, matter of fact, on the move. Borders running over them, tunnels digging them. I be faking them, I be shaking them, man. Cause I don't wanna share a piece of cake with none. There ain't no nations today. So hug your flag and cry. There ain't no nations today. So just wake up and cry. Oh, why?